Come forth, O children, under the stars, and take your fill of love.
From Plato's Symposium, we tell a tale of a party given by a young poet, Agathon.
Where a progression of speeches are made on the subject of love.
Here, philosophy is defined in terms of the love of wisdom.
And the character of Socrates seduces one into philosophy.
This art of love he learned from his teacher,
the priestess
Diotima.
It turns out, Socrates, I didn't know what I was talking about.
It was a beautiful speech anyway, Agathon. Now I'll let you go. I'll tell you the speech about love I once heard from a woman, Diotima. A woman who was wise about many things besides this. She's the one who taught me the art of love. I think it will be easiest for me to proceed the way Diotima did and tell you how she questioned me. You see, I had told her almost the same things Agathon here told me just now. That love is a great god and that he belongs to beautiful things. And she used the very same arguments against me that I used against Agathon here. She showed how, according to my very own speech, love is neither beautiful nor good. So I said, "What do you mean, Diotima? Is love ugly, then? And bad?" But she said,
"Watch your tongue. You really think that? Something's not beautiful and has to be ugly?"
"I certainly do."
"And if a thing's not wise, it's ignorant? You haven't figured it out yet. There is something in between wisdom and ignorance."
"What's that?"
"It's judging things without being able to give a reason. I'm sure you see that this is not the same as knowing, for how could knowledge be unreasoning? And it's not ignorance either. If something hits the truth, it can't be ignorance. Correct judgment, of course, has its character. It is in between understanding and ignorance."
"True."
"Then don't force whatever is not beautiful to be ugly, whatever is not good to be bad. It's the same with love. When you agree he is neither good nor beautiful, you need to not think it is ugly and bad. He could be something in between, you know."
"Yet everyone agrees he's a great god."
"Really? Only those who don't know. Is that how you mean everyone, or do you include those who do know?"
"Oh, everyone together." And she laughed.
"Socrates, how could those who say that he's not a god at all agree that he's a great god?"
"Who says that?"
"You for one, and I for another."
"How can you say this?"
"It's easy. Tell me, wouldn't you say that all gods are beautiful and happy?"
"Not I."
"Well, by calling anyone happy, don't you mean they possess good and beautiful things?"
"Certainly."
"What about love? You agreed he needs good and beautiful things, and that's why he desires them, because he needs them."
"I certainly did."
"Then how could he be a god if he has no share in good and beautiful things?"
There's no way he could, apparently."
"Now you see? You don't believe love is a god either."
"Then what could love be? A mortal?"
"No."
"Then what is he?"
"He's like what we mentioned before. He's in between mortal and immortal."
"What do you mean?"
Socrates. He's a great spirit. Everything spiritual is in between God and mortal. You see, there are messengers who shuttle back and forth between the two, conveying prayer and sacrifice from men to gods, while to men they bring commands from the gods and gifts in return for sacrifices. Through them all divine things passes. Through them the art of priests and sacrifice and ritual, in enchantment, prophecy, and sorcery. Gods do not mix with men. They mingle and converse with us through spirits instead. Whether we are awake or asleep, these spirits are many and various. And one of them is love. my dear Socrates. Considering what you thought about love, it's no surprise that you were led into thinking of love as you did. On the basis of what you say, I'm going to conclude that you thought love was being loved rather than being a lover. I think that's why love struck you as beautiful in every way, because it's what is really beautiful and graceful that deserves to be loved. But being a lover takes on a whole different form.
All right then, my friend. What you say is beautiful. But if you're right, then what use is love to human beings?
I'll try to teach you that, Socrates, after I finish this. Now, according to you, he is love for beautiful things. But suppose someone asks you, Socrates and Diotima, what is the point of loving beautiful things? See, it's clearer this way. The lover of beautiful things has a desire. What does he desire?
That they become his own.
But that answer calls for another question. And that's, what will this man have when the beautiful things he wants have become his own?
There's no way I could give an answer to that question.
Suppose someone changes the question, putting good in place of beautiful, and asks you this. Tell me, Socrates, a lover of good things has a desire. What does he desire?
This time, it's easier to come up with the answer. He'll have happiness.
That's what makes happy people happy, isn't it? Possessing good things. There's no need to ask further. What's the point of wanting happiness? The answer you gave seems to be final.
True.
Now, this desire for happiness, this kind of love, do you think it is common to all beings and that everyone wants to have good things forever and ever? What would you say?
Just that. It is common to all.
Then, Socrates, why don't we say that everyone is in love, since everyone always loves the same things? Instead, we say some people are in love and others not. Why is that?
I wonder about that myself.
It's nothing to wonder about. It's because we divide out a special kind of love. We refer to it by the word that means the whole, love. And for the other kinds of love, we use other words.
What do you mean?
You know, for example, that poetry has a very wide range when it is used to mean creativity. After all, everything that is responsible for creating something out of nothing is a kind of poetry.
True.
And so all the creations of every craft and profession are themselves a kind of poetry. And everyone who practices a craft is a poet.
True.
But as you also know, these craftsmen are not called poets. We have other words for them. And out of the whole of poetry, we have marked off one part. The part the muses give us with melody and rhythm. And we refer to it this by the word that means the whole. For this alone is called poetry. And those who practice this part of poetry are called poets. That's also how it is with love. The main point is this. Every desire for good things or for happiness is the supreme and treacherous love in everyone. But those who pursue this along any of its many other ways, through making money, or through the love of sports, or through philosophy, we don't say that these people are in love, and we don't call them lovers. It's only when people are devoted exclusively to one special kind of love that we use these words that really belong to the whole of it. Love and in love and lovers.
I'm beginning to see your point.
That's because what everyone loves is really nothing other than the good. You agree?
Yes.
Now then, can we simply say that people love the good?
Yes.
But shouldn't we add that in loving it, they want the good to be theirs?
We should.
And not only that, they want the good to be theirs forever, don't they?
We should add that too.
In a word then, love is wanting to possess the good forever.
That's very true.
This then is the object of love. In view of that, how do people pursue it if they are truly in love? What do they do with the eagerness and zeal we call love? What is the real purpose of love? Can you say?
Well, if I could, I wouldn't be your student, filled with admiration for your wisdom and trying to learn these very things.
Well, I'll tell you. It is giving birth in beauty, whether in body or in soul.
It would take divine knowledge to figure out what you mean. I can't.
Well, I'll tell you more clearly. All of us are pregnant, Socrates, both in body or in soul. And as soon as we come to a certain age, we naturally desire to give birth. Now, no one can possibly give birth in anything ugly, only in something beautiful. That's because when a man and a woman come together in order to give birth, this is a godly affair. Pregnancy, reproduction, this is an immortal thing for a mortal animal to do. And it can't occur in anything that is out of harmony. But ugliness is out of harmony with all that is godly. Beauty, however, is in harmony with the divine. You see, Socrates, what love wants is not beauty as you think it is.
Well, what is it then?
Reproduction and birth in beauty.
Maybe.
Certainly. Now, why reproduction? It's because reproduction goes on forever. It is what mortals have in place of immortality. A lover must desire immortality along with the good. If what we agreed earlier was right, that love wants to possess the good forever, it follows from our argument that love must desire immortality. How do you think you'll ever master the art of love?
But that's why I came to you, Diotima. I knew I needed a teacher. So tell me what causes this and everything else that belongs to the art of love.
If you really believe that love by its nature aims at what we have often agreed it does, then don't be surprised at the answer. And mortal nature seeks so far as possible to live forever and be immortal. And this is possible in one way only, by reproduction, because it always leaves behind a new young one in place of the old. Even while each living thing is said to be alive and to be the same, as a person is said to be the same from childhood till he turns into an old man, even then he never consists of the same things, though he's called the same, but he's always being renewed and in other respects passing away. And it's not just in his body, but in his soul too. For none of his manners, customs, opinions, desires, pleasures, pains, or fears ever remains the same. But some are coming to be in him, while others are passing away. And what is still far stronger than that is that not only does one branch of knowledge come to be in us while another passes away, and that we are never the same even in respect of our knowledge, but that each single piece of knowledge has the same fate. For what we call studying exists because knowledge is leaving us. Because forgetting is the departure of knowledge, while studying puts back a fresh memory in place of what went away. That's preserving a piece of knowledge, so that it seems to be the same. And in that way, everything mortal is preserved. Not like the divine, by always being the same in every way, but because what is departing and aging leaves behind something new, something such as it had been. By this device, Socrates, what is mortal shares in immortality, whether it is a body or anything else, while the immortal has another way. So don't be surprised if everything naturally values its own offspring, because it's for the sake of immortality that everything shows this zeal, which is love.
Most wise Diotima, is this really the way it is?
I believe that anyone will do anything for the sake of immortal virtue and the glorious fame that follows. And the better the people, the more they will do, for they're in love with immortality. Now, some people are pregnant in body, and for this reason, turn more to women and pursue love in that way, providing themselves through childbirth with immortality and remembrance and happiness, as they think, for all time to come, while others are pregnant in soul, because there surely are those who are even more pregnant in their souls than in their bodies, and these are pregnant with what is fitting for a soul to bear and bring to birth, In my view, you see, when he makes contact with someone beautiful and keeps company with him, he conceives and gives birth to what he has been carrying inside of him for ages. And whether they're together or apart, he remembers that beauty. And in common with him, he nurtures the newborn. Such people have much more to share than do the parents of human children, and have a firmer bond of friendship, because the children in whom they have a share are more beautiful and more immortal. Everyone would rather have such children than human ones. Even you, Socrates, could probably come to be initiated into these rites of love. But as for the purpose of these rites, when they're done correctly, that is the final and highest mystery, and I don't know if you're capable of it. I myself will tell you, and you must try to follow if you can. This is what it is to go aright, or be led by another, into the mystery of love. One goes always upwards for the sake of this beauty, starting out from beautiful things and using them like rising stairs, from one body to two, and from two to all beautiful bodies, then from beautiful bodies to beautiful customs, and from customs to learning beautiful things. And from these lessons, he arrives in the end at this lesson, which is learning of this very beauty, so that in the end he comes to know just what it is to be beautiful. The love of the gods belongs to anyone who has given birth to true virtue and nourished it. And if any human being could become immortal, it would be he.
All previous speeches are accumulated within Socrates' account of what happened the day when Diotima questioned him, and he is shown that love is desire for beauty, wisdom, and the good.
That love desires immortality through giving birth in body and in soul.
The love of the gods belongs to anyone who has given birth to true virtue and nourished it.
And if any human being could be immortal, would be he.
Just like that, an idea was born.